the food they eat, the clothes they wear, the, you know, birth, death, wedding, all the ceremonies that surround us, you know, that we go through, the rituals in life, the languages we speak. So when, can you imagine, just imagine India, in fact, imagine all of South Asia, imagine the world. Just imagine the number of varied and various ways in which people express themselves in their own cultures, right from indigenous people to people in cities and villages. And India being a multi-religious, multi-linguist, multi-ethnic country, we have embraced many cultures over the years. We've, you know, and I mean stress that, and there's no time to stress that. You know that, right? That is a positive thing. That is the positive ring to the word culture in India, because we have this multi-ethnic, multi-religious fabric, which, if it is positive, we need to retain it that way. We don't want it torn apart. We don't want that very basis being attacked. And I think many of you will acknowledge that in present times, it is being attacked. I will just fast forward now to a phenomena that you all will be, you people are all post-liberalization children. Okay? You're the millennial generation. What happened in post-globalization, post-liberalization, the globalized era? A new kind of, I'm going to look at some phrases with culture. A new kind of monoculture came in. What is that monoculture that happened with globalization? And I remember interviewing Arthur Clarke. You may know, you know, a famous author in Sri Lanka. When I was making my documentary, Michael Jackson Comes to Manikganj, it was about the impact of satellite TV on 5 countries in South Asia. And I filmed from Peshawar to Kandy in Sri Lanka, asking people, what is the impact of this satellite invasion in our countries? And it was just an amazing look at what people felt. And that time when I interviewed Arthur Clarke, he said, it's a good thing that we are having the satellite revolution. But he said, the sad thing is that it has led to the Coca-Cola culture. Does that ring a bell? Do you feel that this is a monoculture that has happened? The burger, the pizza, the Coca-Cola. Right? I mean, where was that earlier? So a kid in New York is having the same thing as a kid in Nagpur. The food has been homogenized. The people pushing that food are corporates who want you to eat that food, however, whether it's good for you, not good for you, and you are a consumer of that. So just trying to, you know, basically I'm sharing some ideas for you to take home and think about. That you are now part of this monoculture, whether you like it or not. And is there something that you may want to choose to be different, to do something, to buck this trend, and maybe not have a Coca-Cola, not have a pizza, and do something different? Maybe have the food that your ancestors ate. That's the new thing, that we would be healthy if we ate the food that our ancestors, jo hamare dada, dida, इन लोग खाते थे पर दादा वो खाना अच्छा था और क्या हम वो खा सकते हैं या हम ये मोनोकल्चर में हम I'm trying my Hindi, I'm not very good at it. I now live in South India, I'm a Bengali, married to a Punjabi. I'm truly Indian in every sense, but I speak better Kannada now, a South Indian language, than I do Hindi, so but I'm still trying to communicate with you. This is one sort of culture which we have landed with post-globalization. And so I'm just parking that thought with you. Satellite technology, I mean, which I have been very much part of that revolution in that sense, you know, taking part in it as a person from television who started, you know, in news when satellite TV first opened up. And, you know, Doordarshan would show only ribbon cutting of politicians. And the first image on satellite TV on private news was politicians throwing mics at each other in the parliament. So that image was bahut powerful image tha private television mein, you know, when the satellite channels opened. So, you know, everything that happened. Now, satellite is now, I mean, now it's something we've digested it. We've got on to the next phase of social media. You, the generation out there seated in front of me now, how many of you are on all the time? You don't read newspapers, you don't consume it on paper. You do everything on your mobile phone, right? And you are on Instagram, you are on Twitter, you are on Snapchat. And how many of you are on Tinder, dating each other? Come on, admit it. Okay, so 90% of your time is spent on this medium now, which is again, something that is a post-globalization thing and of course, a technology of the moment. How it is all going to pan out, we don't know. Already there is a lot of critique about it. So what's happening? You're dating, you're talking to virtual friends on your Instagram. Instagram, I think, is only putting photographs. I'm not on these platforms. I don't like to share my photographs with everyone. So I'm just saying that, but other platforms, Facebook, etc. You're talking to virtual friends. Aapke virtual friends hai. Reality mein kitne friends hai. It's time you ask those questions to yourself. Ki mera real friends kaun hai? Yeah, really, are all my friends just parked in cyberspace? Kya ho raha hai? Dating ho raha hai on social platforms? Breakups ho raha hai udhar? Again on social platforms? And then the very ugly and chilling things are happening there. And it's happened in Bangalore yesterday. One girl has committed suicide virtual. She's kept it. She's killed herself while filming it, and she's, you know, let everybody see it and said a very sad thing, saying, please like this video. Your life should not, please, this is my appeal to you. This is the one thing that I can, that message, if you will value it, I will leave it with you, and it will make the effort of coming to Nagpur and speaking to you. Please re-evaluate these things. Your life should not depend on this monoculture again of technology, where your life depends on somebody saying like to a message you put. You have to have real friends. You have to live in the real world. Try to stay away from this world. I mean, not you can't, you're in it. You cannot reject it, but evaluate it, be conscious of it. These suicides, etc., that are taking place on virtual, people are cutting themselves. I mean, it's we've lived our lives, we've had great lives. You know, the future is yours. And we don't want to see our kids going that way. We don't want our kids to not be in touch with reality. What are the other things that happen? There's technology. We talked about the chilling effects of technology. One of the other chilling effects of technology has been, and we call it, I don't know, we can call it culture, whatever. We are a sun-loving society. Shall we say our sun preference is a cultural thing? We can say. Ye to culture ki baat hai. Kyunki beta jo hai, wohi last rides karega. Beta jo hai, wohi hume dekhega jab hum boodhe honge. लड़कियां तो शादी होके चली जाएंगी. Is this our culture? It's high time we question that. Simply because, again, technology has been used to eliminate the girl child, resulting in a terrible sex ratio. आप लोगों को सबको पता है that we have less women in this country than men. Kerala is the only state where there are more women than men. And that's the way nature wills it, because girls have a better surviving rate. And it's not something that you can say ki us and them, ye to gaon mein hote hai, ya slums mein hote hai. People who go to Oxford and Cambridge are doing sex selective abortions. Delhi had a rate, I made a film called No Country for Young Girls, and it showed that Delhi's, the number, the sex ratio was 825 women to 1,000 men. If this can happen in the capital of India, where there is a Supreme Court, where there is Parliament, then what are we talking about? In this country, don't you think it's hypocritical that we worship, we say culture, we say we worship Durga, Kali, this ma, that ma, but we worship female goddesses. But when it comes to our own girl children, we're happy to just get rid of them in various forms, whether it is before birth, after birth, by starving them, not giving them enough nutrition, or I don't have the time, nor do I want to bombard you with statistics here, but I am leaving some thoughts with you, on ideas that you may already be familiar with, but I just want you to dwell on them later. Think about it. And all of you girls who are here, please realize that we have to buck this whole thing of a sun-loving India in whatever way we can. And for you, your career should be on the front burner and not your marriage. I mean, I see a whole lot of girls on the right-hand side. Is there a division? Boys on this side, girls on this side? I'm not able to see it because I've got this light flashing in my face, but it shouldn't be like that. You should be mingling not only in the virtual space, but right here. Men will learn from women and women will learn from men. And this is not a gender battle where we divide lines. Men have to change because women are changing. And that's when we cannot just have hypocrisies about our culture, about female goddesses, when, you know, we get rid of our own daughters. There is something also called, increasingly, you know, we say aspirational. You know, we have an aspirational culture in India. It's a word that is often used, and in cities, you people will be picking it up and saying, "Hum to aspirational generation hai." Ye ek naya ek terminology aaya hai hamare beech mein. Ab aspirational kya hota hai? Hamare liye sabse best example aspiration ka kya hai? 700 crore ka shadi. किसका शादी क्या शादी मैं नहीं बोलूंगी क्योंकि मेरे ऊपर क्रिमिनल डेफेमेशन आ जाएगा तुरंत हाँ पर आपको पता है मैं किसके शादी के बारे में बात कर रही हूँ और किस तरह के शादी के बारे में बात कर रही हूँ और क्या हमारे देश में जहाँ हम लोग अभी खड़े होकर बात कर रहे हैं यही विदर्भ में जहाँ फार्मर्स वही पेस्टिसाइड खा रहे हैं जो उन्होंने अपने क्रॉप्स के लिए लाए थे क्या ये शोभा देता है हमें आप लोग सोचिए क्योंकि अगर आप सोचेंगे नहीं तो ये इसका चलता जाएगा आप भी बोलेंगे हाँ हमें शादी करना है शादी को आप फ्रंट बर्नर में रखेंगे क्योंकि यू विल वांट दोज 5-day बॉलीवुड वेडिंग्स सेंस करे या ना करे पेरेंट्स को हार्ट अटैक आ जाए टू फुट ऑल दोज बिल्स और नॉट द बॉयज फैमिली वोंट पे एनीथिंग द गर्ल्स फैमिली हैव टू पे एवरीथिंग We cannot model ourselves on, you know, I was talking to a professor from Harvard last week who was visiting Bangalore. He said, such weddings are unacceptable in the West, where you have this naked spending of wealth simply because you have the wealth. Please begin to question that what is aspiration about? Is it just your personal aspiration for all this? Are you going to do a wedding which a Bollywood star does, a cricket star does, and top industrialist in this country does? Are you going to say hanker for that? Or are you going to do something different? Are you going to say, I'm going to wear my grandmother's sari because it means a lot to me and do something different? Are you going to write a new script on culture? Or are you going to go on with the old cultural norms that have been put, in front of us. I just want to say that you'll probably say, oh my God, post-lunch session, Gulab Jamun Baba kha ke aa rahe hain, or Nupur Basu is boring us with this, gloomy picture of India. It's not a gloomy picture. I'm a very happy person. I'm very optimistic. And the thing that gives me hope really are those people, those women who have nothing, but they are the most radiant, and I cannot get into those stories right now in front of you, but sometime we will have some sessions and documentary films with you. We do plan that. But, so it's not that we have a gloomy view of our country, but we do have a utopian view of our country. All I'm saying is that try to think of these issues. Don't be ostrich-like and bury your head in the sand and just do what others are doing. Don't be like sheep, just following trends, whether it is on Twitter, whether it's on Facebook, whether it is on... Think, please think. Something's been placed between your ears for you to think. Think originally on all these issues of culture that I've touched upon. For me, these are important because I felt and experienced one of the worst, one of the times that I remember I came back home and I couldn't sleep for days was when a farmer's family, 7 people lay dead in front of me, you know. Farmer, his wife, and 5 children. You don't want to see scenes like that. And I hope you don't have to, unless you become a journalist. And I hope you still don't have to. I hope we can change things in our country. But we can't if we continue the way we are continuing, by celebrating all the wrong things in this country. I just hurriedly written down some notes. I was in a flight sitting in the flight for 4 hours this morning because of bad fog. So that really sapped me of all my energy. So do forgive the rambling. I just wanted to refer to something contemporary on Sabarimalai. You know that, how many of you know of that controversy that's going on? How many of you think that women should enter that temple? I want 100% hands to go up. Well, that's almost 80% and many... Hey, you guys at the back, you don't want us to enter the temple? Whichever temple. Shall we keep you out of the Kamakhya temple? Because that was by Goddess Kali. Shall we keep you guys out of that? No, I'm just asking a rhetorical question, that what is this? And in the name of tradition, what are we doing? The whole world is laughing at us. Here we are supposed to be solving our problems on the ground of hunger, of education. I mean, I don't even want to give you those figures, but I mean, you know them. You're on your Google all the time. You just have to look at where India has slid on the hunger index, where India has slid on the development index. It's all there in front of you. Instead of concentrating on that, should our news channels be constantly doing this Sabarimala thing? Take off the oxygen of publicity and the women will enter. It's the oxygen of publicity that is being given to all those... a group of motivated people who don't want women to enter those temples. It is like Sati. It had to go and all these have to go. But we have to keep pushing if we want to change what we are, who we are, what kind of culture we want for our country. We have some amazing speakers after me, so I'm not going to take all the time. I just want to say that whether it is... I do want to say something about journalism from the profession from which I come. Things have changed there also. In this country, and I will end with this point, in this country where Gandhi started a newspaper to throw the British out, where journalism was used as a tool to gain our freedom from colonial masters, in that country, journalism today has become one of the most dangerous professions. I, as a journalist, have to share this with you all. In the year 2015 and 16, according to the government's own admittance in the parliament, 145 journalists have been attacked in this country. And a large number of them are being killed. We are no longer safe doing the job that we do. My friend in Bangalore, Gauri Lankesh, was killed. She had 7 bullets in her. After she had put her edition to bed and she was just coming back home, only because she had different views. In this land where Buddha was born, where we knew, where we looked up to traditions in Buddhism like tarka meaning not the dal tarka that we know, but tarka, where you debate, Have you ever seen the Buddhist Tarka where the two monks stand and they debate? It's an amazing experience. Sometime if you go to any of the Buddhist monasteries, you will see. We celebrated Tarka, we celebrated debates. Debate what you have to, but don't kill people. Don't shoot the messenger. If journalists get killed, we go to the field to report, knowing that you people are there to back us. Civil society is there to back us. But if you kill us, then there'll be nobody to get you the real news. We can all have different views on things, but that doesn't mean that, you know, you murder us. The number of women that are getting killed the world over, last year 63 journalists across the world got killed, highest ever number. Out of that, 10 were women. One of the journalists was from Malta. Gauri was coming back from work and she had 7 bullets in her. The Malta Panama Papers journalist was going to work and there was a bomb ignited under her car. Why? Because she was trying to expose the corruption of her president. So they just eliminated her. 10 journalists have been killed. The UN says that women are being attacked in 2 different ways. They're being attacked both physically now. Earlier they would say, we'll kill the male journalist, we'll just rape the woman journalist. Now they are saying, put a bullet through her, end her. So they're killing her, and what else are they doing? They're trolling her. Women journalists get trolled every single day, and that is another technology misuse, where you know what is happening with trolls. Women journalists are being trolled, saying they'll be raped, their children will be kidnapped. The men never get told that their children will be kidnapped. It's as if they don't have children, as if they don't have families. But the women are being told this, and death threats are being openly issued on trolls to anybody who has a different view. Is this our culture? Is this what Gandhi fought for? Is this why he started Swarajya? What has happened to Indian culture? I leave you with these thoughts.
Thank you, ma'am. She pointed